run free. You do it all by your own efforts or lack of effort, really. You stop making an effort to meditate. But, in fact, there is a sacrament in Vajrayana Buddhism. Buddhism went through several phases. First of all, like ancient classical Buddhism was later characterized as Hinayana, the lesser vehicle. Mahayana is a later development, was a more thoroughgoing philosophy of no thingness, and it broadened the scope of Buddhism to be not just something that monks and nuns did, but everybody can practice it. It doesn't matter if you could be a butcher, a wine seller, you can still practice Buddhism. And in the very last stage of Buddhism, there came a beginning in about the 5th century. There were these scriptures called tantras, which appeared simultaneously in all the Indian religions. It's really a mystery where it came from. I think perhaps it's something to do with the invasion of India by the Scythians, who Danny mentioned earlier, and the Scythians, as Danny said, were notable for their drug use. So, in fact, one branch of Scythians was known to the Chinese as the Hunters of Soma. So, I'll do it upside down. Okay. There. So, before I get on to Buddhism, we should discuss the Vedas. So these are four books, Rig Veda, Sama, Yajur, and Atharva Veda, which were composed, we believe, sometime from linguistic evidence. They were composed between 2000 and 1000 BC. The Rig Veda is the oldest, and it's, in fact, the oldest religious text still used by any religion. It comprises a bunch of hymns arranged into 10 chapters called mandalas. And these hymns were those that were chanted in one specific ritual. And this is called the yajna or the agnihotra, fire ceremony, literally. And during this, this ceremony, the priests, the Brahmin priests, made this drink called soma, consumed it, got high, and believe it or not, they ended up the ceremony with a freestyle rapping contest. I'm not joking. There are many suggestions as to what soma was. Somebody brought up this morning, before the talks, somebody asked me, what do you think of the suggestion that soma was Syrian rue? Well, that's a very interesting thesis, and it suggests that there was something a little more psychoactive than Syrian rue which accompanied it. Which something that would perhaps contain DMT, which would be potentiated by the beta carbolines in the Syrian rue. And it could be combined with ephedra, which is, in modern Farsi, is called hom, like halma of the Avestan language, which was a cousin to soma. So I don't think either of those were actually soma, but I think in Persia, in the Zoroastrian religion, both of those may have been used, although if used together, it's very dangerous, you could die. Lotus has been suggested, although no specific species and no pharmacological evidence has been provided for this hypothesis. Somebody a guy called Space, S-P-E-S, wrote a book on it. Thoroughly unconvincing in my view. Hawaiian baby Woodrose isn't actually Hawaiian, it comes from eastern India, Bengal, and down south from there. Now that is believable, that is a potent psychedelic. And the Brahmanas, the commentaries on the Vedas, speak of a substitute for soma, which is known as soma lata, which means soma creeper or soma vine, and it's quite likely, in my view, that was this Argyria nervosa. Now, fly agaric has been proposed first by our boy Wasson, and then by other writers like Clark Heinrich. And there seems to be a lot of support for this. Wasson got a lot of flack from Sanskritists and so on by saying it was Amanita muscaria. But then he only looked at the Rig Veda. He did not look at the other Vedas, which we'll address in a moment. Psilocybe cubensis was suggested by Terence McKenna, and I think there is a lot of there's a lot of good reason for that to be the case. And the most ridiculous of all suggestions for soma was the last one here, rhubarb. Not only this guy suggested it was rhubarb wine, but the problem is soma was made during the ceremony and consumed. You can't make wine in a space of 3 hours like they had for the ceremony. And besides that, rhubarb doesn't grow in India. It's found in the, like just below the Arctic Circle in China. So let's have a look at the Yajur Veda. It has three completely different versions. There's the white, the black, and the partridge colored. That's right, Titania, partridge colored, and speckled, I think they mean. And they speak of two kinds of soma. You've got the red and the blue throated. Now, red could easily be the Amanita muscaria, bright red, brilliant red mushroom. And blue throated, well, there is a kind of play on words here. I mean, it's quite easy to see blue-throated as meaning blue-stemmed, but the word for throat is kanda. So there is another word, kanda. You see, they sound very close. And kanda means stem, whereas kanda means throat. So, yes, let's see. The bright red and the blue throated. My contention is that as the people who call themselves Arya or noble migrated from Central Asia into India, they passed through an area which is the Oxus Valley. And fairly recently, it's been discovered that there was a civilization there. And it's known by the incredibly ugly and cumbersome name of the Bactria Margiana Archaeological Complex, the BMAC. So I prefer to think of these people as the Oxus Valley Civilization. And it is known they had a practice of sitting around a fire taking drugs. So that's where I think these people picked it up, the Arya picked it up. They lived with them for a couple of hundred years, didn't mix with them much, but they interacted, and then they moved south through the Khyber Pass into northwestern India, where they were the people with the Vedas. And they had a set of gods which are almost identical to the Greek and Roman gods. For instance, King of Heaven, Jupiter, was known as Indra. the king of the god of the sky, including the stars and planets and so on, was called Varuna, just like Uranus in Greek, Uranus in Latin or in insults. These gods actually faded from view. The Vedas kind of lost their power in by about 500 BC. By about 1000 BC, we had lots of commentaries on the Vedas, and as the Vedas seem to be centered around the use of soma, you can see why they faded from view as the climate changed, the ecology of India changed, the great divine forest, the Deo Dahu disappeared. And so as Amanita sky depends on trees, it cannot grow without a host tree, as it has a mycorrhizal relationship with the roots of certain trees. Well, before the Aryans invaded, northern India was a cattle-based culture. And so there would have been lots of psilocybe mushrooms growing on the cattle dung. And so that is probably why the mentions of blue-throated soma and blue-throated gods comes in to replace the old Vedic notions. And by the way, in the Vedas, in the Vedic period, ordinary people didn't have religion. They didn't do religion. There was a professional class that did religion for you. And so if you wanted some religion done, you would pay Brahmin priests, and you would give them an animal to sacrifice, and they would take the psychedelics for you. And this was forbidden to ordinary people. By the way, in Sanskrit, oh, by the way, in case you didn't know, Sanskrit is not a natural language. Sanskrit was concocted from five different dialects. And when they put it together, they removed all the irregular parts. So there are no Sanskrit irregular verbs. It's a completely logical, consistent language, but it has a huge vocabulary. I mean, like twice as much as Greek. You should see my Sanskrit dictionaries at home. You can stand on them to reach high shelves. They're huge, but there is not one single word for mushroom in their entire language. No word for mushroom, which suggests to me that it was removed. They decided not to include it in the new language. When the Brahmins concocted this new language, Sanskrit, they left the words for mushroom out. And there's evidence for this in the earliest Indian law book. It's called the Laws of Manu. Manu is cognate with our word man and human. So just like in the ancient Germanic myths, the first human is called Manus. In the parallel myths in India, he's called Manu. And he's supposed to have written the first laws. Now, in the Laws of Manu, it says that you shouldn't touch a mushroom. In the commentaries, they say that he who touches a mushroom is guilty of wounding a Brahmin priest. Very serious crime in those days. Those degenerate people who insist on eating mushrooms are guilty of killing a Brahmin priest. This is equivalent to murder. So the Brahmins who wrote this stuff were really serious about keeping it to themselves, keeping the secret within the caste. So we come to an entirely different kind of book now. I believe that these Puranas, these compilations of myth and legend, reflect an indigenous substrate of myth that was entirely different to the Aryan myths and was there when the Aryans arrived. but it didn't express itself till about 500 BC. And as I said, many of these books contain the myth of churning the ocean, the Samudramantanam in Sanskrit. And the ocean in those days was made of milk. I don't know if any of you were aware of that, but apparently this is the case. The ancient ocean was actually made of milk. And there was a constant struggle between the gods and the anti-gods, a bit like the gods and titans in Greek mythology. I have to believe that the various races of anti-gods were in fact the races of people that the Aryans encountered when they invaded India. Now, according to the Puranas, the Aryans have been defeated quite comprehensively by the anti-gods. And so they went to the god Vishnu and asked, what can we do to regain our pride and settle these disputes with the anti-gods? Vishnu suggests that they do a cooperative venture. And he suggests churning the ocean of milk to manifest the various treasures which are hidden in it. Now, if you think about it, these are cattle-based cultures. Churning milk into butter was the highest technology they had. So, what they did was they took a mountain that had lots of trees on it, and it was called Mount Mandara. They turned it upside down and put it on the back of a giant tortoise, or turtle, who was sitting at the bottom of the ocean, and they wrapped a giant snake spirit around it. They then hauled back this thing back and forth, churning the ocean for 1,000 years, and a lot of great treasures came out of it. But there was also a byproduct called halahala. So the god Shiva drinks the halahala, which causes his throat to turn blue. This is why Shiva's throat is blue. So there was another product, surabi, also known as kamadenu, the wish-granting cow. Instead of milk, she gives soma, also known as amrita. And of course, it's no coincidence that Psilocybe cubensis grows on cattle. So that's probably the reason this is a wish-granting cow and not a wish-granting elephant or something. So, fast forward 1,000 years, we come to the advent of tantric Buddhism. These tantras arrive from who knows where. And in these tantras, Buddhism has its own version of Shiva. They're called Avalokiteshvara. He wears many of Shiva's attributes. He has a blue throat, just like Shiva. He carries bow and arrow, a flask of medicine, which, by the way, this the name of this medicine, long before anybody spoke of someone being Amanita muscaria, a British researcher in the 1890s said that on etymological analysis, the word used for this special medicine actually means urine. So, we know about the practice of urine drinking in connection with Amanita muscaria use. So, this is the beginning of the Vajrayana Buddhism, and which is characterized by the use of Amrita. This is an Amrita flask. And it is a very common feature of Vajrayana art. These are just a few pictures of Amrita vases. I have hundreds of such pictures. And it's commonly seen in a skull cup, a human skull used as a drinking vessel. And you notice how amrita is always like churning and roiling to indicate its activity. This is saying this is an active substance. And you get often skull cup of amrita on top of a vase of amrita, and occasionally a vase of amrita on top of a skull cup of amrita. And in art, you see deities depicted as drinking amrita, and this one on the right shows Hevajra standing significantly on one leg, like a mushroom, and holding 16 skull cups, all marked with different animals and gods. So this is possibly indicating that there were 16 kinds of amrita at this point. We know that in the final stage of Vajrayana, there was something called Panchamrita, which means the fivefold amrita, and it comes down to us these days as punch. So the you know, punch didn't need to be spiked. It was originally psychedelic. And so lots and lots of famous Buddhist saints hold amrita in a skull cup. So what was it? Here we come to the nub of the issue. There are enough clues in the literature and in Buddhist art to actually identify the species of mushrooms that were used. On the left, Psilocybe cubensis, and then a Japanese mushroom, Psilocybe liniformans, also found in northern China. And it's this last one, very, very distinctive, Psilocybe argentipes, the silver foot, that means. And Paul Stamets, in his book on the psilocybe mushrooms of the world, psilocybe mushrooms of the world, he describes Psilocybe argentipes as adorned with fragments of the cortinate veil. And you see the little adornments around the edge of this. These are all, by the way, described as being parasols. Now, if I said there's no word for mushroom in Sanskrit, if you actually wanted to talk about a mushroom, you said parasol or umbrella, chatra or atapatra in Sanskrit. Throughout the literature, you get these references to parasols, but they're really talking about, rarely are they talking about parasols. It's usually mushrooms they mean. Not only mushrooms, the cult of Tara involves like many, many references to acacia. I believe that Tara, who occurs in Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism, is actually older than Buddhism, older than Jainism, and Tara is the planet Venus, and she is also associated with acacia. Now, in Sumeria, Ishtar was the planet Venus, who was also associated with acacia. Well, there is a specific version of Tara called Kadiravani Tara, which means Tara of the Acacia Grove. Now, this word Kadira refers to a particular species of acacia, which is very rich in DMT. So we have very many different entheogens included in the literature, but disguised by using certain symbols like the wheel, the peacock, the wish-granting gem, and peculiarly the bump on top of a Buddha's head called Yushnisha. I believe this refers to psilocybe mushrooms, which are characterized by a bump on their heads, and umbo on the pileus, it used technical language. Now, so I most significant takeaway from this is that when people say, why are all these gods in Vajrayana Buddhism? Other kinds of Buddhism don't have these gods. Well, my answer is slightly different from the usual answer that, oh, they're all designed from different personality types. I say, no, that's not the real reason. The real reason is that they're all different drugs. And so we have a whole class of drugs that have these deities, and there's a whole class of deities that refers to psilocybe, the Ushnisha deities, which have, according to Western scholarship, can't be explained. There are people who have expressed a bafflement of what these deities represent. I maintain that they represent the genus psilocybe, like as here, which has the umbo, the bump on the top of the head. My book on the subject is, I don't have a snazzy like commercial like Danny did, but my book, also I should have had copies to bring here, but unfortunately the printer dropped the ball. So it'll be out in a couple of weeks. And it's called Secret Drugs of Buddhism, and provides a lot of the reasoning behind my statements. You might think I'm just winging it and inventing stuff, but read the book. So, any questions? Do we get questions now?